Hello and good morning again to everybody. Today we would like to tell you in this slot something about using R components in business critical real-time applications as we do it in our company to predict incoming invoices, to optimize the handling of these invoices and to direct it to the best skill group to work on these invoices. So first I would like to introduce ourselves. Next to me, my colleague Ulf. He's a mathematics and statistics expert and member of our team. And I'm head of data warehousing, business intelligence, customer intelligence and statistics using R. And we are from a company named Allianz Managed Operations and Services. And this company is a company of Allianz. And Amos provides services, IT service, all around the world for all our group members. And as you can see on this slide, Amos is located in 14 countries, and there are 43 locations to support with IT and business services. And yes, on this slide you can see where we come from. We are from Germany, we are from Munich. Not everyone on this picture stays now in Munich. One of number 31 is now in London?
Manchester.
Okay. And the mission of Amos is to provide services, and our goal is within this company in detail to provide services for Allianz Germany. So in my department we set up the data warehouse for Allianz Germany. We built customer intelligence data marts, and we do statistical services using R. And what we do in this context, my colleague will now explain in detail. So I switch to the next. And I've done my part. Ulf, good luck.
Okay. Thanks, Peter. My name is Ulf Schöpsmeier. I studied math in Munich, and I did my PhD. And 1 year ago, I applied for a job at Allianz, and I came along Peter. And this was the first slide he showed me, what he is doing with R. So I just know R in university, but all the things around he had to explain to me. And now I try to explain it to you. Okay. Everybody should know R. So we have an R service. That's here's the R code in it, and you can add some config files like a CSV or some R data files with some statistical models and a lot of data you can add. And that's one of the biggest points I want to talk today about. First, how we make our web services. The whole R code is encapsulated in Java to make a web service. So when we have some clients or applications outside, we can call the Java web application with a SOAP request with XML. Then we transform it in Java to R. Then we can do some transformation or aggregation, whatever you want. Then do your calculation, transform it back, and then transform the R output to an XML output, and then you can give back your results to the caller. And around that, you can do some security issues or logging and exception handling. And now I want to talk more about the inner core, so what we do here in R and what is in particular with the topic big data. So we have a lot of challenges to face, and that's what Peter told me 1 year ago, why he needs some statisticians and some R coders. That we have a lot of big data I will show you in a couple of minutes an example about 60 million lines and 200 columns. So it's a quite big data set, and we need it for analysis, but also in big memory, because we have to be very fast in production, and we use this whole web application in production now. So everything has to be very fast, and we need quite high performance, runtime stability, some security issues, and we have to combine it, for example, with databases to get our data, or to combine it with other data. So we need some interfaces with databases or other languages, for example, Java or C++, and it has to run on Linux, on Windows, or whatever. And in the end, we have to do, since it's in production, we have to monitor what we do. And therefore, we use some Shiny, and maybe in the end, when we have some time, we can show you our Shiny app too. But here are some keywords. The big memory package, maybe some of you already know what big memory package is. It enables you to store your data in the memory, in the shared memory, not just in one R process, but you can store the pointer to this data and then give this pointer to other R sessions, so you can use the data from other R sessions too. And since it is in the shared memory, it's quite fast. And another point is that we want to do it in parallel. So when we have several calls or clients here, we want to run our service for many clients, so we want to do it in parallel, and on the server we can do it with rserve. And when we want to do some analysis, we can use, for example, the for each package. But the focus today is on big data, what we can do to handle the big data and to make it fast. So as I said, our data set has 60 million rows and 200 columns, and it's quite big, I guess, and usually you store such a data in a database. So we do it with Oracle. At Allianz, we have an Oracle database, and we now have to pull our data out to R, and that's the first issue. And we want to have multiple access to the data. So if you every time connect to the database from R, it's very slow. So it's better to have it in the shared memory to be fast. And the challenge here is that we have several thousand jobs calls per day. Or if you have some analysis data that we plug in, let's say 1 million data sets, and we want to combine it with the big data which we have in our database or then in memory. So the keywords are to use shared memory and to do it in parallel. So to wrap it up, we have a data warehouse here where our data are. We want to supply the data to R. And the first issue is that it is a very big data matrix. Then we want to have fast access. And the third point is many parallel calls. And maybe in the end, we want to do the analysis in parallel too. Okay, the first issue. We tried to load all the data from the database in a data frame and then save it as an R data object. You can do it with, for example, RJDBC or Oracle when you have the connection to the database, and then use the big memory package. So when you do that, you can load your data from your R data object and then put it into a big memory object, and the function is as big matrix. But the problem here is that all columns are assigned with 8 byte. So remember, we had 200 columns and 60 million rows, so we end up with 90 gigabytes in the memory. quite big. But when we load the data, you have the RData object in your memory and the big memory object, so it's twice in the memory. So 2 times 90 gigabytes. And in production, you don't want to delete your data and then load the new data, but you want to do it on fly. So there's a function in the package big memory, it's called deep copy. It changes the data on the fly, but therefore you have the data 3 times. So the old data, the new data, and the R data object. So it's quite big. And another problem is to load the R data object is very slow because it's zipped, and to unzip it, 90 gigabytes is quite slow. So we have that was one issue. So our idea was that we split the data because we have seen that most of the columns have only very small numbers. So we don't need 8 bytes. So we can split it into char, short, and double. And most of our data are short, so we only need 2 bytes. So we have some data sets with double and some with short. And then we can load it separately into big memory objects. So we end up with only 30 gigabytes, but still we have a problem that is 3 times in memory when we do the deep copy. So the solution was to do the split not in R, but in the database. And then to select the data with SQL Plus and store it to CSV files. So we have 1 CSV file for double and 1 CSV file for the short. And then the trick is that you can load the, to the big memory object the CSV files directly. You don't have to load it to R first. So only you have to the data once in your data, in your memory. And that's the big advantage with the function read big matrix. The only problem is that you have to give them the call names that you can identify later on when you want to do your analysis, when you want to work with it, that you can use the names. You have to give him the names and just put it in a TXT file and load the TXT file. So that's quite good. In the end, we have only 30 gigabytes. Remember, at the beginning, we had 3 times 90 gigabytes, so it's a lot of reduction. And we are much faster because we don't have to unzip the data from the R data object. Okay, the next point is we want to have very fast access. Okay, you can say when we use in memory, we are already fast enough. But remember, we have several thousand calls a day, and if each call takes 1.2 seconds, it's quite long if you have so many. So if you do the standard search algorithm when you want a specific line in your 30, in your 60 million rows, it takes 1.2 seconds. There's a function mwich in the big memory package, which is designed for big memory objects. So it can search your data quite fast, and then we can have the time to 0.55 to find one specific row in your data set. But we said that's not fast enough, we can do more. So since Peter said we are from a database department, we learned something about databases. And usually what you do in databases to have quick access to your data, you build an index. So we built an index for our data too. Don't worry about all the code here. It just splits your data in blocks. Let's say here 1,000 blocks. And then you only have to know in which block your data lies. And then you only have to search one of these 1,000 blocks. So the amount of data is reduced. So now we end up with with 0.013 seconds. That is fast. And how we do it, it's given here. Select the index which in which block we have to look at in the index, and then there's the function sub big matrix that you get only the data you need, only the block of data. Then for the double and for the short, you can do it search with mwich, and in the end you put all things together, and then you have the data you need for your specific number, your specific row you need. And so we end up with this very fast algorithm. Okay, the next challenge is we want to do it in parallel, many parallel calls. So as I said, a big memory package is designed that you can use many parallel R sessions. And the idea is that if you have a big memory object, that you have the pointer to the data. So it's written in C, and then you have a C pointer. And you can store your C pointer and give the pointer to the next session, and every session who has the pointer has access to the data. So we can open many R processes, and every process has access to the data. And the solution we use is in combination with Java, and our web application is rserf. We can open many parallel sessions with rserf. And how does it work? Okay, we have seen, we have our data warehouse, provide the data to R, and then we have the data in our shared memory, and we have stored the pointers to it, and now we can give every pointer to every R session we want. And the R sessions are opened by rserf, which is installed on the server, and our clients send a request to rserf, and then rserf can split up the calls into several processes. So we can do everything in parallel. And one step more, we use two machines. So we have our service and rserf on our machine with all web applications here, and we have a JBoss before that, and we have a second machine with the same infrastructure, and then on top of that we have an Apache server who do the load balancing. So if you have a request from some clients or some applications, it goes to the Apache. The load balancer says, okay, one machine is busy, go to another machine. Then he decides, okay, go to the second machine, and on the second machine you can do all the calculations in parallel. Of course, we did some performance tests and load tests, and you can do it, for example, with SubUI. I don't know if you know it. That you produce some XMLs, send it to the application, and do it many times. And so with our two machines, and each machine has 24 CPUs, we end up that we can have around 60 threads in parallel. So that's quite good. And we tried with several scenarios with different data and different configurations, and we end up always with something like that. So we can handle 60 calls in parallel. That's quite good. And okay, the next step is we want to do analysis. What I showed you was the web application, so when it's called from outside, but before you can do that, you need a model. So we want to model it, and therefore we have to do some analysis on R. And therefore we need the big data objects too, and we don't want to use rserf because it's not the best way to do it in parallel for just analysis. You'd want to have it in one session. So, but you can parallel in one session with some other packages too. Therefore, we use before each package, or we try the dplyr package where you have the MCL apply, which is a parallelized version of L apply, which you may know from base R. And you can give how many cores you want to use and what function you want to calculate. And here, for example, I have some code how we call the for each package. We use it with do parallel here with 10 cores. Then you give all the packages you need. And if you use the data table package, you're even faster because you can transform your data frame to a data table object and make an index on it. So it's very fast and quite faster than a regular data data frame. And if you do some math too, that you have, for example, I have two specific columns who identifies my data set. So I can use, for example, I have a customer number and a date, two columns, and make out of it the combination, because some customers send in their invoices two or three times, and so every time I have a new row, but I want to add the same data to it, so I just can use that, and I have a unique combination between the customer identifier and the date, for example. So for the combination of the customer ID and the date, it's one combination, and for each combination I just have to run my analysis once. And so I can do some clever things for parallel. And I can do it with MCL apply too. And in the end, some numbers, how we end up and fasten all the things is when we use, for example, 10 cores, and I have 30,000 combinations, which are 150,000 rows, and I want to add with a big memory package my data, when I just need 6 minutes. And if I don't do it in parallel, it would be hours. And you can see if you go up with the cores and up with the combinations, it's still quite good that you need for 1 million rows, 2 million rows, only half an hour. So quite fast. Or another example where we used for each package, we had an old aggregation step in it. Oh, I'm sorry, that's German, not English. It's old, it's the black one, new, the red one, and the ratio old versus new is the green one. And it's the calculation time here. And the old one goes up if we increase the number of rows in the aggregation quite fast, up to 10,000 seconds. But when we do the for each loop with 20 cores, it stays stable down here. And when we look at the ratio, if you get more and more data in it, we get a ratio of 20 in the end, so we use all the cores perfectly. Okay, one more thing in the end. Since we are in production, we have also a Shiny app for it. And here we can show how good our things are running in production, and if the servers are, for example, online, and how many calls do we have. Maybe it's working online. We can have a look. Here, for example, you can choose which server you want to see, and then it goes to the database, looks which logs we have, and then we can see, okay, how many calls do we have, and the green line is how long does the service take to do the calculation. It's around 1.5 seconds, that's quite good. And you can add some statistics. You can change the plot if you want, remove something or add, and do all the stuff you want. And you can have a look at some aggregated data. Okay, it's not the best resolution here, but you can have, for example, have a look at the last 30 days, the last 100 days, what is going on my server. And yeah, that's the near real-time stuff we hit in the title. Okay, I guess I was quite fast. So we have time for a lot of questions.